say that never mind. And today's controversy is coming from yet another member. Hey, yo, of the hip hop community. Pablo, a new artist signed under the dive.
Hey, yo, go get my ball.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, cats and dogs. This is the premiere of the Unemployable podcast. I'm your host, Pat, and I'm here with my co-host, Trey. Trey, tell everybody how you doing.
Hey, Pat, how you doing today, buddy? Also, I call him Nate.
Yeah, you're going to hear that throughout the podcast. He'll be calling me Nate Dogg. We'll explain later why he does that. Some of you might find it funny. Some of you might be like, I don't know about this. But, yeah, that's going to happen. All right, Trey, so I have a lot of things we want to talk about here today. First, like, one of our things that we're going to go into is the college football season.
Yeah, a little bit of agenda. This is the first time we're doing this. We've talked about this probably for over a year now, but we had time to actually do it. I call it Nate Dogg. A little story after that is probably back in 2009, one of our best friends, Sean, we were going out all the time, and I never could remember his name, Patrick. So I'm just like, hey, man, he is African-American or black guy. So I wanted to say, hey, I can't remember his name. So he looks like a rapper, you know, like Nate Dogg or Warren G.
He doesn't look like Nate Dogg.
He doesn't look like Nate Dogg, but ever since then, always call him.
All of us look like Trey. We're not a monolith.
Exactly. So he is Nate Dogg for me. And then when I tag him on Facebook or other social media, I tag him as N-A-T-D-O-G-G. I know that's Nat Dogg, but that's our inside joke.
Don't even spell Nate right. You just spell Nat.
Exactly. So that's our inside joke, but I always call him Nate Dogg, but his name is Pat or Patrick. But what we're going to talk about is, there's a little backstory on that. What we're going to talk about is, first time we're doing this, might have some technical difficulties, but we just wanted to have an open forum, and we're both podcast listeners, big time fans, so we just wanted to kind of do our own thing. We're going to talk about some college football top 25 action, also probably go in a little bit of NFL and how bad our fantasy football teams are. And even talk about a little UFC and possibly getting in a little of both of us being single and in our dating life.
So, oh, yeah, that's a doozy right there. I'm sure you're all going to love that part of the show. But before we get into that, let's get into some college football. So, Trey, Trey's a huge Georgia football fan, Georgia Bulldog fan, and they're playing this week.
We're at Missouri. First off, just complete embarrassment last week. It was really depressing. We played a team called Nickel State, probably bottom five in the FCS. Supposed to come in there. I think the Vegas spread was 49 or 50, 56-point spread, something like that. It was crazy. And we basically just took it down to the wire, and we barely beat them 26-24 after a huge win the first week against UNC. Nick Chubb had 222 yards. Last week was his first time. And I think over 14 games, he hasn't rushed for over 100 yards. Basically, our offensive line was terrible, just got whipped, and just was really disappointed. But we did get the win. We are 2-0, but don't really know what kind of team we have. Jacob Eason, true freshman, five-star, really highly touted, looked pretty good in spots last week, but just kind of struggled at the end. He threw a pick, and they returned it inside the 10, about 91 yards. So this week, just want to go in there and see how they do on the road. The defense played pretty well last week, but Kirby Smart, first-time coach, replacing infamous Mark Richt. Had a lot of friends. It was a huge deal that Mark Richt left last year after 14 seasons. But just really excited to see how we do this week. A little nervous. But I believe the point spread is like 6.5 on the road at Missouri. They blew out Eastern Michigan, I believe. But anyway, really interested in that.
They only won by two against Nickel State. I guess Nickel State's a small school in Louisiana.
Exactly. Basically, they gave them $525,000 to come in there and get murdered, but they pushed it to the max.
And they're best known for, if you watch the Netflix documentary, Last Chance U, they got like two recruits defensive tackles from there.
Yes.
One of them, I think, was Ronald Ollie. who was like one of the stars of that show, who's probably one of my favorite characters on the show, but that's beside the point. A game like that, you only lose two to a team that you probably should have beaten by double digits. You feel like that is a learning moment for them, teachable moment for Georgia there? Like, you need a game like that to get scared? So, like, kind of, hey, like, we're about to go in the gauntlet of the SEC, it's no joke. Or are there some real concerns about the team?
Yeah, great question. I think, first off, they got a little big-headed, or a little confident, overconfident from the win last week against, you know, UNC was ranked, and we, you know, we beat them 33-24. But I think coming in, it was a 12 o'clock game, you know, SEC Network, hate to say Athens fans, just hard to get up tailgate. The crowd was kind of dead, and this team was really motivated. It was actually their first game. They didn't even play the first week. And originally they were supposed to have a freshman quarterback, and they rolled in with, I forgot his name, but another actually a senior, and they rolled in with freshman quarterback. That was a little surprising. He played really well, and I think it was one of those just underestimated them, and basically Georgia just got dominated on the offensive line. That's their weakness. Like, we got, you know, great running backs, but I mean, like I said, when you 20 carries and Nick Chubb only got 80 yards, he's a Heisman contender, and a touchdown. I mean, that was just really. So yeah, there's a lot of key questions there. If I was Missouri and we got Ole Miss after that, or as I like to call them, Ole Piss, we've got some really good defensive linemen, lines that we're going against, and I just think it's going to be really challenging. So they got to get that fixed this week. So to answer your question, offensive line and quarterback problems, but I'm hoping Kirby Smart can use his coaching staff to help on that.
Because going to that game with Carolina, I don't remember what the point spread was, but there were a lot of people picking Carolina to win that game. Exactly. And there's some people even saying that Elijah Hood was probably the best running back on the field, or coming into that game on the field, and even a Heisman candidate. But Nick Chubb, of course, came in and had a really dominant performance, had about 200 yards rushing. So you think that game there, I think you probably hit on that, but that game there kind of just like, all right, this is going to be kind of easy picking for us for the rest of the year, setting us up top ACC opponent, quality ACC opponent. And then also, like, you can kind of say the SEC East is in flux because of a lot of coaching changes. Like, Florida, they're in their second year with their coach. South Carolina changed their coach. It's like the top two schools. You guys changed your coach. Where do you see, like, the next few weeks going with Georgia?
Yeah, actually, after the first week, I was really excited. Got a big win, like we mentioned earlier, against UNC. I saw Tennessee struggle against Ab State.
we'll get into them later.
Ab State. We got Nate Dogg over here, is a Ab State alum. I am a little known fact, huge Georgia fan, but graduated from Georgia Southern. I actually played a little college football there, walk on, that's another story. But, yeah, we're excited. Like, Tennessee struggled against Ab State, had to go into overtime, so I'm just like, maybe Tennessee's overrated. My little pick was Tennessee was going to win the East. Just, you know, Butch Jones, great recruiting class, had everybody back, great backfield. But Butch Jones, infamous for, you know, pooing the bed in big games.
Oh, yeah, so far.
Yeah, making bad decisions. So
Oklahoma at home last year.
Exactly. Had them 14-3, had them on the ropes, pushing Bama to the brink. But anyway, I was picking them to win the East. Didn't really know what Florida had. Florida struggled first game against UMass, but blasted, I think they blanked Kentucky like 45-0 last week. Jim McElwain, great coach, a.k.a. I like to call him Swamp Donkey. He's got those chompers. But, yeah, they got an easy win this week, and then in a couple of weeks, I believe it's going to be Florida on the road at Tennessee. Florida got 11 straight against Tennessee. That's impressive. Man, that's just complete domination. I don't even know if you call that a rivalry anymore. So if they win this year, that's 12. So anyway, back to your question, I was really excited, but now I have no idea what Georgia has, and we're just going to go game by game, try to get the win at Missouri. But yeah, the East should be SEC East should be interesting this year.
Missouri's not the same Missouri this year, are they, right? Because Gary Pinkle is out, right?
Right. Yeah, so. got a new coach. I think their defensive line's a little down. They're usually been well known for their defensive line. And little known fact, the last 2 years, actually, Missouri hasn't scored on Georgia a touchdown. in the last two games. Last year was a 9-6 baseball shootouts, boring, terrible, couple field goals. And then 2 years ago, we went on the road coming off the Gurley suspension, and Nick Chubb had his coming out party. I think it was like over 30 carries, 143 yards, and we blanked him 34-0 in Columbia against a pretty good Missouri team. I think they ended up winning the winning the East that year. But anyway, so I just feel like we should be really motivated coming off being humbled against Nicholls State. There's all I like to call them, school of the blind. So that's my thoughts on that. Anyway,
hey, they earned that $525,000.
Yeah, exactly.
So another big game coming up this week. Alabama, Ole Miss.
Or as I like to call them, Ole Piss. Exactly. Saban, I think he has this one circled, coming off they actually lost to Ole Miss two straight years. And just really funny this past week, if you saw it on YouTube clips or ESPN, they were and the reporter was like, "Hey, basically there was a chewing on the sideline," and he's like, "Hey, hey, coach, we saw that Lane Kiffin, you were having an argument," and he's like, "No, that wasn't an argument. That was just a good old. That was an ass chewing," and he just said it right, dry sense of humor, Nick Saban. So it was really funny. But I think
Nick Saban has humor
in his own way. but 38-10 against Western Kentucky. Hilltoppers are the way I like to describe them, as the Grimace, because that's what their mascot looks like. But yeah, I think point spreads are roughly like 9.5, but I see Alabama being really focused, probably beat them by 10, 14, somewhere in there.
So there's no way in hell Ole Miss beats them a third year in a row.
Yeah, I don't really see it.
Hugh Freeze has Nick Saban's number.
I agree, but I think this Saban's got this in circle. He really wants it coming after national title. And then that was their blemish last year. Ole Miss came back, beat them. I think it was 5 turnovers, just some crazy like pick 6 plays. But and another thing, I'm kind of deep down pulling for Ole Miss because we have to go on the road at Ole Miss, and if they're 1-2 and we're rolling in there, it's not looking good for the Dogs. So just being a Georgia fan.
Why is it not looking good for that? Just for motivation factor? Maybe it's a possibility that chance Ole Miss might be having a down year, even though supposedly they have the best quarterback in the SEC.
Exactly. Chad Kelly's good. Also, got a little speculation going on with the whole, like, might have been paying some players, got the Tunsil thing. So, I don't know. I think their program's maybe not headed in the right direction, but on the field.
There's really an investigation.
Yeah, I mean, Larry Tunsil coming out saying they gave him all that money. One of our best friends, Sean's called out, man. He's, not related sources accurate, but, over 200,000 Super Bowl tickets, all this. Offered, and another little known fact, early commit, I think his junior or senior, all in on Georgia, and then Ole Miss comes in on the back end, steals that recruit, 5-star coming in. Then they also gave his sister a scholarship for track or some sports related. So anyway, I just don't. Ole Miss just coming out of nowhere after some 6-7 wins, they get a top 1 or 2 recruiting class out of nowhere.
A little
shady.
Here's how I feel about that. What school doesn't cheat?
What school doesn't cheat? I agree.
Like, even in the high school, like I was classmates with some like guys on the team, and they had some SEC scholarships, and one of them was like, one school's offering his girlfriend a scholarship just to get him to go there. So when I hear stuff like that, just like, so what? It's just like, the whole, if you're not cheating, you're not trying. But it's just like you're just stupid enough to get caught.
Yeah, I definitely agree. That's a sensitive subject. I mean, I think knowing Mark Richt ran a clean program, obviously we had off-the-field issues, all the suspensions. I mean, every year it was, 4 or 5 players.
Georgia, was this like this first or second year there was a Georgia player in the headlines in the offseason?
Actually, I think we had 3 or 4 guys. We have Jonathan Ledbetter, who got DUIs. He's actually getting probably AA support. He's not playing this week. I mean, he might play after Game 4. So not the usual Georgia suspensions. I know Mark Kirby Smart jumped right into that, but we were infamous for having 4 or 5.
Yeah, every offseason, it was always several dudes just on the program was always just being on the police blotter.
Exactly. See, Clark County and Athens are all about locking up some dudes. Like, I think that Georgia has their own jail cell where it's for the Georgia players. Then you got, I've also said, Coach Saban, or as I like to call him, Papa Saban, has got Tuscaloosa locked down. Good old boy network. I mean, I've heard him like, hey, the guy's getting pulled over. They'll call him in the middle of the night. He'll be like, hey, just send him on down to the dorm. I'll handle it. Probably get run him to death. And then, man, I also wonder about, man, they've got some of those dealerships locked down, giving out cars. There was always that infamous Derrick Henry Heisman.
In Tuscaloosa.
Tuscaloosa a couple of years ago. He got all of a sudden gets a brand new Dodge Challenger or Charger, one of those cars, putting it on Instagram. I mean, you're just getting that all of a sudden. He's from a real small town in Florida. Not judging it. Not saying his parents weren't well off, could afford it. But getting that in college, I mean, he was great.
Now,
Just throwing that out there.
Does Kirby bring that culture to Athens?
I think he's bringing, hopefully, pretty clean so far. I've heard really great things. I went to the G-Day game over, 93,000. Had to turn 3,000 or 4,000 away. It was crazy. And when he said, hey, I'm coming home, I just felt like brand new culture, trying to turn the program around, getting away from that 9 or 10 wins. You know, we're going to try to move towards the playoffs. So,
because I feel like this is what you guys wanted, right? After all those years, Mark Richt ran a clean program. Exactly. He won 19 games a year.
Yep.
He's the only guy in
guy in 14 years not to win national title. Tennessee won one, Florida won two, Alabama domination. You could say he was in the Saban era. But, I mean, you got just Auburn. I mean, like Gus Malzahn a couple years ago, first year coach, comes in, takes him to the national title. And you're like, we want that. We were just in cruise control, 9-10 wins, which is great. I know a lot of programs would love that. But, we're Georgia, man. We're 35 years. I've never seen one since I've been born. My mom was pregnant with me with Herschel Walker. We're, like, living off Herschel Walker reruns. And, like, you're tired of it, man. And you can never say a Georgia fan was a bandwagon fan because we went through a lot. Injuries. Look at our running backs recently, Todd Gurley. I'm a little mad at him right now. We'll get into that a little bit about my fantasy team because I'm picking both of my drafts. But Todd Gurley's great. I mean, we had No'Shawn Moreno, Keith Marshall recently. And basically, I'll go off on a tangent here. If you're a running back coming to University of Georgia, you're going to get there, but you might as well go ahead and get ready. You're probably going to blow a knee out because every great running back recently, knock on wood, Nick Chubb, great dude, man. Like, I love to see that the other day. Is he blew out a knee. I mean, Sony Michel, freakish four-wheeler accident, breaking the forearm. I mean, it's like great recruiting. We got 2 4-stars coming for next year, but probably going to get injured when you come to University of Georgia. Just get ready. So I just want to throw that out there. But I'm hoping Kirby's bringing a new environment, new culture, and we got a clean program. Just saying.
I'll give you a that on, being a Georgia fan, not a bandwagon fan, because when I was growing up, Georgia was pretty much – them, South Carolina, pretty much same savages. Like, 6 wins a year. I didn't really think they had that much talent. And then all of a sudden, Rick comes in, changes the program around.
He did.
He won a couple of SEC titles.
Yep.
But it just wasn't good enough for you, was it?
Wasn't good enough. His shot, his number one shot, and it haunts me till this day, 2012, Alabama on the ropes, driving down there, 32-28, the tip ball to Chris Conley from Aaron Murray, great quarterback. Actually, just got picked up by the Eagles this week. Little known fact. Got cut by the Chiefs. I'm glad somebody picked him up. Great dude. But yeah, that haunts me till this day. I mean, we had them on the ropes. I don't care what anybody says. We win that game. We go there and run. I mean, just like run the train, beat the wheels off Notre Dame.
You really think you'd have beat Notre Dame that year?
Yeah, we would have been. Hey, Todd Gurley, great offense. Would have beat him. Hey, defense. You had 7 or 8 guys that end up going in the draft. I know Todd Grantham was the DC that we're terrible, but I think we would have beat him. We just had better players. We matched a great Alabama team, blow for blow. Like, that was, to me, the national title game for 2012. Anyway, that was his shot. After that, you can just kind of tell 2013, we're like 8-5, lost to Nebraska, and another worthless Florida bowl games, like 11 a.m., 12 a.m., snoozer, hungover, watching the January first game. 2014 should have been great. I mean, at one time you had Todd Gurley and Nick Chubb in the backfield. I mean, you're never going to see that kind of talent. Then Nick Chubb, Todd Gurley, excuse me.
I feel like that's an annual thing with Georgia, though. You'll never see this kind of talent on either side of the ball.
Yeah, they would all they would always just, you know, underperform. And, like, you have all this talent. And look at it. Nate Dogg sent me a text the other day about, you know, A.J. Green, 180 yards. Rashad Jennings, one of those backs, like, yeah, several tackles.
Rashad Jones, safety on the, yeah, on the Dolphins.
Matt Stafford blowing it up in that comeback against the Colts, you know, over 300 yards, 3-4 touchdowns. Just great talent. I think at one time Georgia was, like, first or second with the most NFL players in the league. I mean, just, like, all this talent, top 10 recruiting classes, and you're getting 9-10 wins. We just, you know, 14 years, man, we just wanted one. Just give me one. I'll take one and then take 3 6-6 seasons. But I just want one before I die.
Let's go. I'm about to go on another tangent here.
There we go.
Which is a more enviable situation, or least enviable, more enviable situation? Georgia football or being an LSU fan?
LSU has won one, so I would say bit better program. They did get one with Saban. Going back to Saban again, not a big fan of him, but as his numbers, he's got 5 national titles, the best coach hands down as of right now. Second to the Bear. I was a big Bear fan. It's a whole other story. I grew up around it. But domination right now, I don't know what he's doing there. Could be doing some shady stuff. Just saying. But back to your question.
Like going forward, because
LSU's got some problems with Les Miles. They barely brought him back. Rumor was, I heard it, that Jimbo Fisher had the contract sitting right there. Jimbo Fisher was going through some marital problems, got some stuff going on, maybe wanted to get out of Florida State.
This is a chatty patty portion of the show.
Hey, did you hear that too? Did you hear anything about that?
Seriously, like, Jimbo Fisher would left every what good situation he has at Florida State.
Just because personal problems.
It's because personal problem. He would go to LSU. You don't think that's a lateral move? Actually, I think that's the worst move because he has to see Saban every year when he can just run roughshod over
ACC. Had his national title with Winston a couple years ago. Great team. And then now, like, kind of rebuilding it. Great offensive coordinator, and you're going to get that defense every year. What's LSU lacking? Offense. Brandon Harris, terrible. Kid can't throw an offense to him. Kid can't throw 10, 15 yards. You got Leonard Fournette, probably the Heisman contender. I'm a little pro chub.
It just amazes me Les Miles can never find a quarterback.
Exactly.
And the one time he did have a quarterback, he had to take him from Georgia because he had off-the-field problems.
Yep. Zach Mettenberger.
And he did nothing with the talent that they had.
Getting Georgia rejects. Hey, Nate Dogg brought that up the other day. I think he texted me and asked me. He's like, you're telling me in the state of Louisiana, great fertile ground for recruiting, they can't get a great quarterback.
Not even a great quarterback. Just somebody that's just
6'5" white dude. Yeah.
Just like somebody that's just accurate. Or just somebody that's just even a game manager.
Exactly.
Like, it just seems like Les is just putting athletes behind there playing quarterback and just like, all right, just do what you can. It's not like not even teaching him or trying to develop him at the position.
Exactly.
Just has so many busts, like so many high rated busts.
I agree. Great defense, man.
But the thing is, the one year they did have a quarterback, that's when they got affected by like a bunch of underclassmen going to the pros on defense. Because they had Odell Beckham, they had Landry, they had, I'm sure they had like Collins and Lael Collins and Trey Turner on the line.
Exactly.
Mettenberger at quarterback, Jeremy Hill at running back, and they still did nothing with it.
Exactly. Kind of similar to Georgia.
Yeah, so like I feel like those are two similar situations where there's teams that have a bunch of like transcendent talent and just still never can beat Nick Saban.
Exactly. I mean, we're living in the Saban era, just domination. So it's going to be interesting to see like LSU coming off that little bit of embarrassing loss to Wisconsin first game. Basically, just get kind of punched in the mouth, manhandled. Same. I don't know. Going back to this, Cam Cameron.
Oh, he's terrible.
What was he previously?
Baltimore Ravens coordinator, and he got fired when they went on that Super Bowl run.
Right. But, you know, pretty good resume. But I'm trying to think, like, I was watching the other day on ESPN, they brought up a good point. Is it Les Miles is kind of stubborn, old school, like just want to run the ball, play defense? Or is he kind of like he's limiting Cam Cameron? Because I think, you know, he's kind of like spread the ball around. He worked with Flacco. So I don't know if it's inter- – I mean, he wanted to bring him back. He could have like, all right, man, I made it this year. Maybe I need to get a new OC. So there's some OC guys out there. So still not sure if it's just, is it
you know, the Mad Hatter, Les Miles, or is it just he's just, I don't know, they're not changing, they're not evolving. So
he gets fired though. Someone's going to pick him up in 5 minutes though.
Oh yeah, he's definitely attractive coaching hire. Guy I'm going to throw out there that just he wants a bigger job, even though I heard there's an incentive if they make it to the Big 12, Big 14. Is we talked about it in the pregame here. Well, Tom Herman got him rolling in Houston.
And where's
so
he going to go?
I'm going to say LSU. Let's say Les Miles stepped down. SEC job coming from Houston. But I have heard that there is a $5 million incentive if he stays for it and they get promoted to Big 12, Big 14.
I know that's like the hot name right now.
Tom Herman rolling.
It's still like early in the season, so who knows? Things could turn around. But
yeah, big win against Bob Stoops in Oklahoma. AKA, what's his name?
Big Game Bob.
There it is. For a while there, it was Big Choke Bob, but he won some big ones. But that was an impressive win. Baker Mayfield and that kind of high-tempo offense. So that was a big win. But looking at Houston's schedule, got some just really kind of cheesy games coming up like this week. Looking at the spread here, Cincinnati, Thursday night, 7:30. That'd be a pretty good game. But, I mean, they should go, you know, they're probably 12-1, 13-0, something easy until an offense. But, yeah, getting to that, we'll look at some of the games.
Some of the games going on.
We're also going to roll in here into some NFL because we're a little time-heavy there. But, anyway, some good stuff. But, yeah, coming up. Any games you want to mention there? We talked about Ole Miss, Alabama. That's the one I really want to see. But good slate of games.
FSU versus Louisville.
Yes.
I want to see if Louisville's quarterback's the real deal because...
What's his nickname? He's got a nickname.
Action Jackson.
Nice. Good 80s movie back there. Check that out on Netflix.
The first game they played, local team here, UNC Charlotte, who's only been playing football for 3 years. So... I think he had like 8 total touchdowns that game, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, he's really good. But going against Florida State, Jimbo Fisher, we talked about earlier.
The first two games he was going against like UNC Charlotte and Syracuse.
School blind, first one, definitely. That's what I like to call them. Sorry, these small teams, man. You know, give them 500, 750, and just go in there and get massacred. But yeah, that should be a definitely interesting game. What's the Florida State kid's name? Sorry, it's like Francois or something.
Yeah, DeAndre Francois.
Yeah, he's balling, son. They got Cook, Davion Cook, great running back. I'm just gonna go Florida State, Jimbo at Louisville, and going against Georgia's old DC, Todd Grantham. Kind of choked some big games. I don't know why he's still there. That guy's lucky to have. Anyway, that's a whole other thing. But I like Florida State winning that one. Probably kind of close. Another game I want to circle here. This is a little bit for Pat here. The U, an old Mark Rick Georgia coach, heading into App State on the road, 12 o'clock ESPN game. I don't even know if they can hold Miami's crowd.
As
here we go.
As an alumnus of Appalachian,
been playing
State.
Pretty good. Hey, tough Tennessee game, blew out the team last week, 1-1. Much improved.
Yeah. So I feel like after this game, unless they win, like the national coverage team, just go back to being, we don't care about them. Exactly. I honestly don't understand how Miami is playing in Boone. I mean, I do know, like, just from talking to boosters and everything, like, something about a home and home, they had an open date, and Miami took it.
So look at this, man, looking out here. Got tickets for $181?
Yeah, it sold out in hours.
Wow.
It sold out in hours. I even heard something where ESPN is broadcasting the game, and... they require 25 tickets. Oh. They have 25 tickets. They can't find 25 tickets to give them. Right. That's how sold out this game. And this is like this is the biggest thing that's probably happened ever to this campus. A top 25 team coming to Boone. Yeah, I don't think anybody ever saw the day this would ever happen.
All right, let's throw this out there. The infamous 2008 game. Would this be, I know not as big. What was Michigan ranked that down? You probably know that.
Top 10.
Would this be close to that big of an upset? Even though App State a little better this year. Kind of similar? Put them on the map for sure.
Considering they almost went in and beat a top 10 ranked Tennessee team at the time.
In Knoxville on the road, over 100,000, the Orange Men.
It's not going to be the level of the Michigan game because you go in a big house and nobody expects you to win and you upset them. They're still living off of that win about 10 years later. They're still living off that win. But that will be the biggest thing that ever happened in that town. This game is the biggest thing that ever happened in this town, other than the three FCS championships they won.
Exactly. Yep, so that should be definitely an interesting game. Also, from what Nate Dogg says, might be a little weed smoking there. Am I right? Said, what do you say? Got a little liquor flowing, weed smoking. That's the early tailgate, though.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing else to do up there, but, you know, that's why they call it happy, happy. But if you want my prediction, Miami in a blowout.
Wow.
Right. Don't worry, I don't send checks to the alumni association, so they're not going to be mad about what I say.
Yeah, I think looking at the point spread is like 7 or something. So Nate Dogg going Miami, take Miami,
taking them in a blowout,
taking them in a blowout. All right,
they're going to outclass
alumni. All right, interesting. All right, Whoa. What else you got here?
I don't think your roommate's going to like that. All right, nah, it's good, it's good.
All right, we're good. looking at some other ones we're missing. Alabama, wonder what the night game is. Hey, here's another interesting I like. East Carolina 2-0. Big win against NC State. No, NC State, a little down for all those Wolfpack fans.
NC State.
Yeah, East Carolina going on the road at South Carolina, Sandstorm, Columbia. Hate that place. Actually probably going to that game in a couple weeks when Georgia goes there. But man, Muschamp, first year, 1-1. Got a blowout last week against Mississippi State. So man, I like East Carolina going in there on the road, beating South Carolina. South Carolina's offense, atrocious.
You think 2 weeks in a row they're going to take a loss?
Just saying, man. They're talking about this team being like 4-8, 3-9 again this year. Not a lot coming back. Like defense, decent. Offense, bad. Got two quarterback system. Got Orth and that McElwain kid. He just runs around back there. Depending East Carolina, pretty good offense. The Beach State put 33 on them. NC State. Just saying.
Depending on
how I would bet on it, but just
we got to bring on my South Carolina buddy on here so you can talk to him.
We'll go that all day. Go ahead and bring up Spurrier. I will say this. We helped put the nail in the coffin against Steve Spurrier. He's ready to hang it up after that Bulldog 52-20 ass whipping. Loved it. I was there, sitting there with my buddy Todd. Loved it. I noticed how he kind of hung in after that because he used to say, I always love playing Georgia. They always got all the suspensions at the first of the year. Well, I loved retiring him. And he quit the old ball coach. Halfway through the year, it was bad. And I love to see it. Hey, God forbid him, he's good. And then you had to go back and be ambassador or whatever with the Gators. Hate the Gators too. So we're coming for you this year, Hype.
He said he didn't quit coaching. He's still looking to coach high school football.
I think he just wants to go play golf, man. Another small thing, the reason why he wanted to go to that Columbia job for all those years, member of the Augusta National. Got to play on the course, one of the best ever. That was a little perk in there. Anyway.
Yeah, when's that game, like 2 weeks from now?
Yeah, that one is October 8th, Georgia at South Carolina. Man, early in the year I thought we were going to wax them, but I have no idea now. That one's always a dogfight, always close.
We got to figure out. I'll do like a three-way in here or just try to get them on the phone.
We can do a little call in.
And you two can go back and forth because I think that would be hilarious.
We'll go, let's see, Dollard. We can call him like cock in your ear. He'll give him a name.
Yeah.
Cockhead, cocky, I don't know. Hey, another one might be interesting. You got Texas A&M, that high-octane offense, going against the Gus Bus at Auburn. Auburn, man, I got a feeling hot seat for Gus Malzahn this year. What do you think there, Nate Dogg? Because
I've been hearing a lot about him being on the hot seat.
Yeah.
Man brought you a national title as an offensive coordinator, came back and got you just in pretty much one red zone stop from a national title, right?
I agree, but last couple of years, man, 6-7 wins with all that talent. They don't, you know, Auburn don't play, man. They usually go through. Coach is pretty good. Tuberville was winning, got rid of him. Gene Chizik, they let him go. What, two seasons later? That's another topic. I think they might have bought Cam Newton. I know that's another speculation.
We're gonna talk about stuff from 5 years ago.
My point is. They don't play down there on the plains in Auburn. So, I know he's not going to win the West. I'm thinking like maybe 9-10 wins this year. He still got Bama. Auburn's got to go to Georgia. I mean, this might be a 7-5 team, and they get a lot of recruits. So usually top 10 recruiting class, man. So it's a great recruiter. But I don't know, man. You got that Sean White kid. He's struggling. Who's that last chance you guy?
Paul Allen
on there.
Guy that transferred from Florida State.
Yeah, he's really good. They haven't even put him in the game yet.
John Franklin III.
Yeah, he was highly talented. Jackson kid, Jeremy Johnson, and he was rolling. They thought he was going to be the next Cam Newton after the second half game.
That's
he's
another
terrible.
School here.
Anyway.
Why can't Gus find a quarterback?
Yeah, man, you're rolling with two or three guys. It might be a playbook. I think
even with Nick Marshall, he had to convert him from DB.
Nick Marshall, a little transfer from Georgia, got in a little problems there. Man, telling you, back to Georgia again. All about getting some rejects. LSU, Zach Mecklenburger, and then Nick Marshall. That's another tangent. But I just think maybe, and you can't say it, the playbook, I heard they got like 12, 13 basic plays. They just rotate them or the opposite way. I mean, even Cam said that. He had a lot to learn when he came to the Panthers because he said Auburn's playbook was so simple. That's a whole other thing. But I just think maybe just not good chemistry. I wouldn't put that Sean White kid in there. Noodle arm. Maybe he's a game manager. I don't know, man. But I like Texas A&M on the road in the Plains winning that one. I know we're hitting a lot on SEC. Georgia, Missouri, we talked about that. Nerd bracket. Oh, here's another one. Michigan State on the road at Notre Dame on the Notre Dame Broadcasting Network, as I like to call it, NBC. What do you think about that one, Nate Dogg? Notre Dame coming off that hard-fought victory against Texas, man. That was probably game of the year, man.
You mean they lost against Texas?
Yeah, hard-fought. Sorry. Yeah, I said victory. My bad. Yeah, they lost something double overtime. Charlie Strong, big win. That dude's got his back against the wall with the Longhorns. That was really big. Another big win last week, 2-0. So, I don't know, man. Michigan State, always good. Who's Michigan State coach? I should know that. Always a great
D'Antonio.
Coach. Great coach. Always rolling in with three or four stars, man. And they're always playing up. Made the playoffs last year. I know Bama blasted them. But, I don't know. That should be always close. Maybe I like Notre Dame at home, just home field, because I think Michigan State's probably only averaging a little over 20 each game, something like that. So maybe Notre Dame fighting Irish at home.
Has Notre Dame picked a quarterback?
That's a good question. I think they're still rolling with two, but not sure. I know they scored some more points last week.
So looking like they should just roll with Kaiser for now, even though Malik Zaire's not – like, they have a very good problem with their having two good quarterbacks. When we're talking about schools in the SEC, can't even find one.
Exactly. That's a good point. A lot of two or three quarterbacks in the SEC, man. They just can't narrow it down.
But I think the big game of the weekend is Ohio State going into Norman.
There you go.
How do you feel that one goes?
I think we'll go with – I'm not really a Buckeyes fan, but I think just Urban Meyer and you're going against Big Game Bob. I know we touched on that earlier. But, I mean, I just like maybe Ohio State, about 7 or 10. I think they just got that high powered offense. I think Barrett, man, he's had three, four touchdowns each game, really rolling. And I think at Oklahoma, already took that loss against a good Houston team. So maybe like Ohio State close. Could be a blowout.
You can make this case that Ohio State hasn't been tested because they've been playing kind of cupcakes.
They usually play a lot of cupcake games. This is actually for a while there, they didn't really play anybody till the very end, till Michigan State the last couple of years. They're rolling, 9-10-0. This is actually an early test for them. I actually like that Urban Meyer kind of stepped up and actually played a pretty good team. But should be very interesting. That's number three, Ohio State at Oklahoma. That's actually on the Fox Network.
Yeah.
Getting a little love there. And I guess the other game is going to be that USC at Stanford. Is it McCaffrey? Get to see that McCaffrey kid. He's guns a blazing good, man. Running around. Probably doesn't get a lot of exposure being out there on the West Coast. But probably Stanford in that one for sure. USC got blasted in the Bama game. But, yeah, I like that Ohio State, Oklahoma. Probably going to be watching that Georgia at Missouri at Fitzgerald's, little local spot here in Uptown.
Yeah, Sean was telling me about it. Said it should come out.
If Sean gets the hall pass, that's another thing.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so that's a good slate of games. All right, we're going to jump over here and talk a little NFL. Nate Dogg, diehard Panthers fan. I believe he just came out of hibernation after that Super Bowl loss. Took it hard, man. And I was with him last week. We were at Oak Room, a rare VIP party for us, man.
Thanks for the invite.
Yeah, we were there, man. It was good. Yeah, it was good. Tough loss by the Panthers. We can get into that.
Man, I think Cam took a lot of headshots, man, and I questioned that him just being, you know, 6'5", 240, 250, they don't look at him as like a Brady or Rodgers giving that cushion. They're like, yeah, he's a big kid. You can run around and take it. But, man, I thought like maybe should have had two or three extra, you know, 15-yard helmet spear flags. But hopefully they'll rebound this week against the Niners. But give me your overall thoughts of the game last week, Nate Dogg. What you thought about it?
Run defense kind of concerns me because pretty much their quarterback, Simeon, he really, I mean, as much as NBC and Chris Collins were going to say, he really wasn't that impressive.
And he had two picks, yeah.
He should have had more turnovers. He dropped like two picks. Their running game was very strong with C.J. Anderson, and that's a bit of concern. They just kind of just gashed us into one. And I was watching the 49ers play against the Rams. They did a great job of gashing them all night long because it's kind of the same thing with Gabbert. Gabbert didn't really do much through the air. He had like 170 yards, but like I saw him like skipping balls at players' feet. I mean, the accuracy was just not there a lot of times. And, I mean, he took off and scrambled a lot, which kept the light drives alive. So, hopefully, I don't think, even though the Rams are supposed to have a good defense, I don't think their defense is anywhere near Carolina's. So, a lot of that will just cut out. But, yeah, seeing the way how the 49ers run the ball concerns me. If you want to know how I felt about, like, all the hits to his head, all the hits to Cam's head, like there is a stat that was out there that said last season, him and I think, like, Andy Dalton were the only two QBs that didn't get a roughing the passer call last season. And matter of fact, Derek Anderson got a call before him, which was in the 2014 season, like 4 weeks after the last one Cam got. I just didn't like some of the explanations some people were giving, like, well, you know, he's running as a running back, so, you know, the rules apply, he's going to get hit like a runner. Like, I've never seen players leave their feet and lead with their head to hit like Adrian Peterson and Marshawn Lynch to take him down.
Right.
So, I don't know, I just didn't like those explanations, and I just felt it would have been a different game if they at least called one of those penalties.
All right.
But, hey, that's the game. They see it how they want to see it. I don't think they'll make officials full-time. So, that's just one thing I like about the NFL is you just don't understand the rules on a week-by-week basis because something is called and something doesn't. There's just not a lot of consistency.
Right.
End rant.
What'd you think about, you know, they're up 17-7, kind of struggled there. Do you not like play, you didn't like play calling? Or what'd you think about the offense? Thought the offense kind of struggled. I know, hey, Broncos, awesome D coming off last week, or last year, Super Bowl. But just felt like 17-7 kind of had them on the ropes and just kind of, you know, let them back in the game. How do you see the offense?
The thing that annoys me, though, because last season – whenever they're in situations like that, when there was a point they needed to score, Shula could always dial up plays. Mike Shula, Panthers offensive coordinator, could dial up plays to send them on a drive to get them a touchdown. So, I mean, they're playing an elite defense. They're playing a top three defense. So, it's not going to be easy for them to move the ball. But, I don't know. It just, yeah, we stalled on some plays. I wish there was more. Well, there's got to either, I don't know if it's a Cam thing or it's just an offense where maybe he needs more check down plays.
Yeah.
Just check down more receivers, just take what's there in front of him. Because there's just a lot of long developing plays with the receivers that takes a lot of time on the offensive line to have to block, for Cam to have to hold the ball long enough to get the receivers open. This is how like a lot of drives can stall like that way. So
yeah, I mean it's tough, you know, going on the road at Denver, always hostile environment. It's just tough environment, tough loss. I hate when they ice the kicker, even though I probably would have. I called it. I was like, hey, watch them ice it. It was loud in there where we were at. But man, Graham, you know, kicked that in. That would have been a big win. But you know, early season, you got 16 games. But this week, you got 49ers coming to town. Beat the wheels off the Rams. The Rams, I have to say, probably the worst offense in the NFL. I mean, Case Keenum. I mean, throw that Jared Goff dude in there. They were terrible. He couldn't throw it 10 yards. I'm a little salty because I stayed up and I was fantasy team, 6 points down. Todd Gurley, I'll go ahead and go off my rant here.
I mean, all I need is six, man. Just give me like a junk touchdown, something. They hold him like 47 yards, 17 carries. You're supposed to be best running back coming off Georgia. A little sensitive. Georgia alumni, but just come on, man. 28-0. So basically what I'm saying is they should definitely win this week. I like the Panthers. Just going to be Bank of America staying hyped up.
Yeah,
they crowded the box against Gurley, but you got Cam back there with weapons. I just see him in. I mean, you got Blaine Gabbert. They're going to have fun with him.
I was mad with Gurley, too, because I had drafted him on my team, and I had D'Angelo Williams on my bench, and you saw what he did against the Redskins.
I actually had him. I started him 28 points, and I just need a little help from Gurley. Nothing.
So, I need it. I've been wanting a flex position in my league, and for some reason the commissioner didn't put it in.
No flex. That's weird.
Yeah, I know. Yahoo. Yeah.
Yahoo.
All right.
All right, yeah, we talk a little fantasy now, going back to it.
So where are we getting to, UFC?
We'll talk a little fantasy. One more thing I want to point out. All right, RG3, is he done? Because, man, that's another shoulder injury. And I think, man, Colin Cowherd brought it up earlier this week. I think Cleveland and Buffalo, some of the most worst-run teams, league just – general manager, whatever. I mean, reps run. Just they don't know what they're doing. Tyrod Taylor. I mean, now you got Josh McCown rolling, man. I mean, you're probably looking at 2-14. You traded. Didn't you have a? You could rather first round pick. You traded up.
Who?
Cleveland, and I believe. Didn't they trade?
What? No.
Go ahead,
they traded with Philadelphia, yeah. And they got all of Philadelphia's picks. Yeah. They had the number two pick.
But Philly got the kid
first on RG3.
Yeah.
That was just a really dumb play. That was just a really, really, really dumb play he did. Like, from what I saw on the clip, it looked like he saw the DB on the sidelines and he lowered his shoulder to try to run him over. I don't know if he was trying to make a point or trying to win the amazement of his teammates or whatever. But that was just a really dumb play. Now he's hurt at least 8 weeks.
I think he's done.
Yeah, I was hoping he'd get to resurrect his career because like. I just wanted to see if it was the Redskins or the Shanahan made him, or you know, is he able to like, you know, diffuse all the talk about him? Like he's not very good at reading defenses.
Yeah.
You know, just
a lot of negativity.
Yeah, he played very reckless, but that was a reckless play that he did. On the point of like, I think at best he's a backup now.
Yeah.
He'll just have a backup job. I think his days as a starter is over.
Yeah, I think he's going to come into like a Michael Vick late in his career, just a good backup player like for the Eagles and Steelers.
Best case scenario is an backup. Worst case scenario, he's out the league in 2 years.
Exactly.
But to the point of Cleveland and Buffalo.
Terrible.
I think Cleveland's terrible. Yeah, they're going to be the worst team in the league this year. But I think their future is bright because they're trying like the sabermetric moneyball approach now. So they're just acquiring assets with draft picks. I think they like have 9-10 draft picks every year for the next 3 years. They got all of Philly's picks. They got like Tennessee's picks, They got some teams' picks. So they'll have an abundance of draft picks in the next 3 years. So that talent base is the cupboard's bare there. So they're going to do their best to just try to fill all those positions. You can say like, well, they had multiple draft picks in the past. Bloom, yeah, they did. But at least, like, they recognize that what we did in the past is not working. So, yeah, we're going to tank again, but we're going to try a different approach. So I'll give them that. And, like, everyone's fawning over Carson Wentz after what he did against them last week. It's still week one. We still don't know who he is. And how do we know if the Eagles didn't draft him, he probably would have been a bust. Or not the Eagles. The Browns took him. He wouldn't have been a bust or not, just like all the other 20-something quarterbacks they've had since they came back. Buffalo, I like Tyrod Taylor. I think he's a good quarterback. I think the problem with them is
two franchise quarterback.
I think he is a top 15 quarterback in the league. I think he's top 15 quarterback. I think he's good.
Yeah.
I think the problem with Buffalo is when the new owners bought that team, they hitched a wagon with Rex. Rex is great at just talking a great game, but not really.
He's a pretty good defense. He's a bad offense.
Yeah, he's a great defensive coordinator. I don't think he's a head coach.
Yeah.
I don't think he's head coach material. I think he just does a lot. He does way too much to bring attention onto himself. He usually does says something that ends up like having him put his foot in his mouth. And aside from those his first 2 years where he took the Jets to the AFC Championship, I mean, he hasn't really done too much with the team. And I just think they just I think he's on the short leash. They get somebody stable in there. They get a decent just go to find a good coordinator route like doesn't bring too much attention on himself, like kind of like a Todd Bowles type. I think they'll turn it right back around. They're not too far away in my opinion. They're not too far away. They just I think it's just a change in leadership. It's just
how about this? Hadn't been in the playoffs since 99. Hey,
that is true.
And I think Cleveland went 2002. So that's why I'm pointing out these two just terrible franchises.
Well, we're terrible franchises.
Also, want to mention Bills. You know what Bills stands for? Boy, I love losing Super Bowls. Ding, ding. I love it. I love that.
That's over 20 years ago.
That was tough, man. I agree, but just being a Bills fan growing up, I'm not. I mean, I'm from Georgia. But losing those four like that just blew the wheels off. That's like having a wheel blown off each year. I know that's all another subject. But anyway, looking at the slate of games, I know we talked about we're definitely watching Panthers 49ers somewhere. Wanted to talk about my beloved Falcons. I am from Georgia. I am Falcons fan first, second Panthers. I got Panthers gear. But, man, lost to the Bucks last week. Think Bucks probably going to be second in the South. I got Panthers winning it. I got Panthers. Go ahead and throw it out there. Probably like 12-4, 11-5.
Bucks scare me.
Bucks look good, man. Winston's rolling.
I thought
Dirk Cutter coming into the dome last week and beating his old team. Hey, it's the offensive coordinator. Matt Ryan hadn't been the same since Dirk Cutter left. Kyle Shanahan, terrible.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. Being a Falcons fan, what are your thoughts on Kyle Shanahan?
Kyle Shanahan, he needed to leave last year. Matt Ryan began to question. I don't know what is left on the contract. Might be going free agents looking. I mean, Julio Jones, top five in the league, wide receiver. They brought that Mohamed Sanu guy. I think they ever paid for him, to be honest. Devontae Freeman, he jumped on everybody last year. They didn't know who he was. He'll struggle this year, watch. I mean, Tevin Campbell had more yards last week. Dan Quinn I thought was going to be great because he's focused on defense. But, man, just probably another average defense this year. I look at Falcons' schedule, brutal schedule. You know, got at Arizona, Seattle, Green Bay. I'm thinking like 6th and 10, maybe 3rd or 4th. In the South this year, man. And I'm going to go ahead and throw this out to you. Little known fact, somebody threw it out. Matt Ryan could be rolling. I'm going to ask this fact. Matt Ryan could be rolling looking at fourth best quarterback in that South. Cam's better. Drew Brees, gunslinger. And then I'm getting on the thing, man. Winston might end up being better than him this year. What do you think, Nate Dogg? So you basically, he was one of the top quarterbacks a couple years ago in the South. Now he's looking at very dead last in that division.
Top to bottom, this is the best quarterback division in all of football. I've read, just going on Falcons board, Falcon website, just to see what they're saying.
Falcoholic?
A lot of Falcon fans are kind of upset with Shanahan because they feel like they don't give Matt a lot to audible at the line. Chances audible at the line, just kind of you just have to call his plays and he see it.
Hey, what was your nickname you used to have for him? What was he? Thought it was Check Down Maddie.
Oh, Maddie Check Down?
Maddie Check Down when he had Tony Gonzalez, which is a great option.
That's another thing, too. Yeah. He hasn't been the same since Gonzalez left.
Beast mode, man. Hey, that's another tangent to go off of. Probably greatest tight end ever. You got to go head-to-head with Shannon Sharpe. He's got three rings, but just athletic ability, freak of an athlete, big dude, hard worker. I think he's the most tight end yards of all time, if I'm not mistaken, right? But Shannon Sharpe did have three rings, I believe. So anyway, hadn't been the same against Tony Gonzalez. Good point.
Yeah, he hasn't been the same since Tony Gonzalez. They don't really give him a lot to audible. It's kind of like you have to run Shanahan's offense.
Right.
He was really, even before Shanahan, he was really great in the no huddle.
Right.
He was really great in the no huddle, and he doesn't give him that opportunity either. So, I mean, kind of wonder if he's going to last the whole season, Kyle Shanahan down there. If this doesn't improve,
think Julio and Sanu a little banged up. Saw him limping off the field last week. I think Sanu had a pretty good game. He's got an ankle problem. So, got to go to Oakland on the road. Improved Raiders team. Another thing I wanted to bring up, bringing on that, did you like that ballsy two-point conversion play in the Superdome in overtime? Or was it? Was it overtime?
No, it was in regulation.
Regulation, going for two on the road, Jack Del Rio. What do you think about that?
I loved it because, one, it was against the Saints.
Exactly.
Two, I feel like Del Rio did it because basically they're just saying, hey, neither of our defense can stop each other, so let's just end this game now. But, yeah, it was very, very ballsy move to do that because most coaches just kick the field goal and take their chances in overtime. But
exactly. And especially probably Raiders coming off.
Went on the road.
What, two, three wins last year? Something bad?
No, they had a decent season last year. I don't know their record off the top of my head. Yeah. But, no, just, the old adage, like, you go for the win on the road, you go for a tie at home.
Exactly. So. Get the crowd behind you. Thought it was ballsy. Another thing is Bucks, Tampa Bay, only one to win the South last week, so they got a game up on everybody. But gonna be tough on the road. I see Atlanta probably losing that. They should win. 4 o'clock game. But I see Bucks probably winning. Tampa definitely. Carolina should rebound. I don't know, man. They lose that. San Francisco, it's 0-2, man. This should be definitely winnable. But any other games you want to bring up? Might be a snoozer game. Philadelphia at Chicago, man.
Yeah, I don't know why this
one of the worst quarterbacks. You need to get rid of him, but I mean, just Jay Cutler. You're never going to win with that dude. I mean, they're talking about on SportsCenter. You look at his face. Am I glad to be here? I mean, just can't win with him.
I really don't like the whole body language thing.
Yeah, I just think it'd be painful. I mean, great arm, but then he'll just choke. 2-3 picks, have a good game. Anyway. That Seattle at Los Angeles.
Seattle's probably blow them out.
Yeah.
Actually, for some weird reason.
They might get motivated at LA. What do you think? First game.
For some weird reason, Jeff Fisher always sweeps Seattle, or he'll get at least a win a year off Seattle. And I think that helps keep his job. He'll beat some, like everyone's down, and he'll beat, like, Seattle, or he'll sweep Arizona, and then they're like, oh, yeah, the Rams are finally coming around, and then they go back to being 7-9 again.
Yeah. Plus maybe a little motivation being first game at L.A.
First game in 20 years.
Yeah, and I just hope Todd Gurley goes off, because I got him in fantasy 2 weeks.
All right. I think we talked enough about
football. Yeah, that was a good little NFL. We want to end on talk a little UFC. I'm a big UFC fan.
I'll admit.
Good.
I'm not.
You watch that?
I don't really.
A slate, maybe? I was at Hooters uptown, watched it, a little laid back.
I'm not a big UFC guy, so you're going to have to carry me on this.
I will. Yeah, as the podcast continues, Nate Dogg probably have to carry me a little bit with the Hornets of NBA. Like, Nate Dogg, really great. On NFL, but I believe he's really good in NBA. Probably run circles around me. I can throw a little hawk tangent in there.
Now, who's the big fight? Is there a big fight this weekend?
Actually, this past weekend is what we'll talk about. Pretty good card. First off, UFC 200 in Cleveland, Ohio. It was the big thing was a lot of media around it. Circulation was CM Punk, WWE former wrestler.
He's now getting into
came in, trained for 2 years, had Fox Sports 1 reality show following her all around with his wife, AJ Lee, ex-wrestler woman, Smokehouse, she's hot. So following around, first off, 38 years old, never had an amateur fight. Like, this is going to be bad. I mean, these guys are hired killers in there. The dude, like, you know, this is wrestling, man. This shit is real. Like, anyway, first off, that was going to be tough. Following around, first off, I give him balls for actually going in there and doing this. 38 years old, twilight of your career. He trained at Rufus Sport, who's probably one of the better training camps in the UFC. But basically went in there against 24-year-old Mickey Gall and got blasted in the first 2 minutes. Basically put him on the ground, got beat in the face, and got choked out. And I can see why Dana White didn't. I like to call him Uncle Dana. UFC, probably know recently, just got bought out. WME, or one of those big conglomerate, bought out UFC, $4.2
billion.
$4.2 billion. $4.2 billion.
Yeah, but these fighters still get paid chump change, right?
Yeah, basically, Joel Silva, the big matchmaker, is actually leaving. He got a portion of it. So that's the way they built their empire, is just, you know, less pay, advertising, it made money. Probably if you're going to take a college business class intro on how to build a company, 2001 almost went in bankruptcy. UFC was bought by the Fertitta for $2 million, converted over to $4.2 billion. That's probably one of the best business opportunities, company, whatever. They need to research those dudes. Because you can't be like, go to school and like, hey, I want to be, you know, UFC or a fight promoter, boxing promoter. No. Boxing's a whole other shady type thing. That's a whole other conversation. But anyway, he went in there and he got blasted for 2 minutes, got beat by a 24-year-old who'd had one fight previously in the UFC. But I think it got a lot of attention, probably a lot of pay-per-view eyes, because that's what it's about. But if I was the UFC, we'll get into this in a little bit, I'd probably cut him. I mean, just not in the same...
2 years.
2 years training. He had a couple injuries, shoulder injury, back injury, but he trained.
I was about to say, it really takes 2 years to get in the octagon.
When you've never done it, these guys have been training. Like this one guy, he's probably been training 5 or 6 years. I mean, a lot. And state athletic commission in Cleveland usually requires five previous fights.
And he skipped all that.
He just jumped right into the UFC. So this is my equivalent. Could be a bad analogy here. 18-year-old jumping through college, playing running back, first jumping in there against, you know, Seattle on the road, and you're going to just do a toss sweep over to the right and get blasted. You're like, man, not ready for it, no training. Maybe he was just a freak athlete at 18, like one of these guys used to play in the NBA. But something like that, you're jumping from not being, you know, trained to less experienced until like the NFL. But anyway, I give it to him for doing it. But
so is he done?
I think he's done. He says he'll be back, but Dana White, from what I read this week,
Dana White kind of making more money off him. That's what it was.
Yeah, if he was to return, I would say this, by being a fan, I would say put him on Fox, because you're not having people spend, you know, $60 pay per view. Is put him on Fox, like third or fourth bill, and get a bunch of ratings. Like, hey, it's CM Punk. We know him. That's what I would do.
The last fight I watched was with you, and that was Conor McGregor. He won, like, what, 11 seconds?
Jose Aldo, great. Put him on the mat. That was great. That was a great fight.
That was a great fight.
That was great. Just because it was 13 seconds, and he beat Jose Aldo, who hadn't lost in 10 years, been murking people, running through people, dominating people. So that's what was great about it. Conor McGregor, a couple weeks ago, I'm sure you read, beat Nate Diaz in the second of that fight. That was really good. I'm thinking they should do Conor McGregor coming up on that for, there's going to be an MSG card. First time they've been sanctioned. That was a big deal. UFC, that's going to be in November. So they really need to stack that card. I think it's going to be UFC 205. We can talk about that at a later time. What else I want to mention was Mauricio Verdum defeats Travis Brown. Travis Brown, a little known fact about him, has been dating Ronda Rousey. Ronda Rousey hadn't been in the ring after she got knocked out last year by Holly Holm. Travis Brown has lost 2 of his last 4. We'll talk about him in a little bit. What was really weird about this was after the fight, the trainer for Travis Brown went in the ring and were talking back and forth. I think they were like, you know, taunting each other. And Mauricio Verdum gave him a push kick to the trainer. It was really weird. Like, I've never seen a fighter go and actually try to kick another trainer from opposing fighter team. That was really weird. And they were talking back and forth. But anyway, Mauricio Verdum got the win after that. Travis Brown dislocated his thumb earlier. I think it had on Instagram when there was a picture of his thumbs. Basically, looks like it was like bitten too or something. Kind of nasty. But that was a win. But just Travis Brown hadn't been the same. He needs to get away from that training camp. Same trainer that trains Ronda Rousey. But that was Uriah Faber was defeated by Rivera. Rad favorite man, love that kid, California kid. You might have known him. He was great with the WC, journeyman, company man with the UFC, California kid, got a lot of businesses. Probably needs to, coaches and owns Team Alpha Male, probably needs to hang it up. He's getting old too. And the heavyweight title fight was Stipe Miocic defeats my boy, Alistair the Ream Overeem. Ream followed him for years. Hey, K-1 champion, Strikeforce champion. Dream champion, never had the UFC champion, retired Brock Lesnar back in 2011 when he was freaking Overeem, 265, got popped on the juice later. I think his testosterone was 12-1. But anyway, had Stipe in trouble in the first round, hit him with the left, had him in a guillotine. Anyway, later, Stipe ends up knocking him out. I was real disappointed because he's running around from him, but Stipe wins it. Tough dude in Cleveland. He's a hometown boy, so that was a big win. Any thoughts on this, Nate Dogg? Now you're not really too much on it, but what do you think about UFC in general, just as a different sport? And to me, second favorite thing to watch besides college football, one, Georgia, love NFL, probably my third, I'd say second because that's two sports. Second favorite sport to watch, love it, in the summer, die hard, listen to several podcasts, Chael Sonnen and Joe Rogan podcast.
What I always...
Sorry, I don't want to dominate you here. Go ahead.
No, you're fine. What I always kind of read is there's always this, this not battle, but this argument between UFC and boxing. Mm-hmm. And it seems like but some of these stars think they can go over the boxing. I don't know how the fight was set up. I don't know if they're going to go ahead and box him or they want to do it in a cage match, but they think that they could take out a boxer. But from what I understand is like...
Well, you heard about the rumored fight.
What? McGregor and Mayweather?
Yeah.
Yeah, are they going to do UFC style or are they going to straight up like box?
Yeah, I think if they ever did that, they were going to do boxing. Of course, I think Conor McGregor would get completely dominated. But if it was a UFC fight, I'd say Conor McGregor because... Floyd cannot do anything on the ground. Conor McGregor is experienced on jiu-jitsu on the ground.
Yeah, but okay.
Good.
Okay, there's one thing, but he has to get him to the ground, though.
Yeah.
And if there's one thing that's great about Floyd, he is one of the greatest he may be the greatest defensive boxer of all time.
I agree. Great on hands, but it's different when somebody grabs a leg, puts you in a certain move. The only thing you can base this on, I know he was way past his prime, was the Randy Couture, James Toney. Same thing. Randy Couture, great wrestler, heavyweight. Jan Tony, I know a little bit about boxing. Probably one of the better fighters of all time. You know, pretty good. And he basically went in there, grabbed his leg, got on him, and punched him in the face, and they stopped it. Same thing. I think it was a rear naked choke, and they stopped it. So what I'm saying is, definitely hands down, boxing fight, Floyd wins, hands down.
UFC is
Conor McGregor with the kicks. You could stay away because he is long. And you've got the jiu-jitsu and the wrestling. Like, there's a whole other thing. Could be cardio. But, like I said, in a cage match, no, I'd have to go with Conor. I know that's a little weird. But boxing, of course. And I do wonder if Floyd would, like, play with him for a couple rounds just to beat him up. Because, man, if everybody was saying $100 pay-per-view or they made something crazy, that would be a great – that would make a lot of money if they did that. But I don't even see Vegas sanctioning that just because Conor McGregor's never even boxed. I mean, he could go in and just – get dominated.
Yeah, it doesn't even make sense. Like, even in the past, Ronda Rousey could take out Floyd and, like...
That was terrible, because Holly Holm came in there, hey, like, 16, 17-time women's champion, Golden Gloves back in the day, went in there and just worked her, knocked her out.
Exactly.
So, all that's put to hush. I don't even know if Ronda Rousey's going to come back. I would assume she would have came back. She needs to come back, because she's already lost some of those movie deals. She's supposed to remake Roadhouse. Great. 80s movie.
So what is it? Her psyche that's destroyed, or what
yeah,
do you
I think? Some people, like when they get, you know, when you get punched in the mouth, glass jaw, you never can come back. It's always mental.
So what does that say about her legacy then?
That is really bad. That it's kind of like sore loser. Like you lose once, you can't come back. You should have hunger. I mean, she was a bronze medalist in judo.
Right.
She struggled going up. I think her book. I didn't read her book, but she went through a lot. You know, living out of her car, wanting to make the Olympic team. Always having that push and drive, so I'm not really sure where her head's at, but I think she was so much pressure on top of the world, and it brought her down. But that's really, yeah, good question there.
Now,
go ahead.
You do Muay Thai, right?
Yeah, I've been doing Muay Thai about 3 years, not getting in the cage, but just for the workout.
So there's not like, you don't think there's one person out there that you think, hey, I can take that guy?
In the UFC?
Yeah.
I would say this. By watching him, I don't know about his hands. And I could be going on there. Could have won a couple rounds with CM Punk from what I saw. That guy got work, which he probably has about as much experience as I have because I've never really been. I spar a little bit. I mean, I'm decent. Got some decent kicks. I'm not going to, you know, toot my horn here. But
probably could have hung with that guy in a couple of rounds. Maybe gave him. I don't know about his wrestling. He might have, I mean, I'm not good at jiu-jitsu or wrestling, but I mean, if you had gave me 2 years to train too on just jiu-jitsu in my hands, I probably would have hung in there. I don't know how my jaw is. People say you can't grow a jaw. I might have got hit. I might have been dropped. Glass jaw, but. That's just anybody. Anybody I'd say who I've seen recently, I'd say probably could have won a couple rounds of CM Punk.
Since you're unemployed right now, and I'm underemployed, hence the show, Unemployable, exactly. the title of the show. If this doesn't work out, find a day job. Could you see yourself training to be a UFC fighter?
Me being in my mid-30s, probably not the best investment. If I was in the 20s. Probably live at the gym, mop the floors, have that hunger, but I just don't really want to get beat in the face for a living.
So that time has passed you by?
Yes, it has. I just do it for the workout now and everything. Kind of like my college career without football. You know, I walked on everything. Triple option wasn't my thing. I was a decent thrower, but that's past my time. But podcasts would be interesting. Hey, we'd love to get to talk junk every week and get paid for it. That's why we're doing it, but I wish we would. So anyway, not sure how we're doing on time here, first one, but I wanted to go over Trey's.
Let's keep going. We'll be all right.
Yeah, hey, we're doing. I wanted to go over. I've talked over with another diehard buddy of mine is Trey's washed up list because he used to always laugh at me, so I wanted to bring this up. This is basically guys that I think need to hang it up in the UFC.
Okay.
Just like they're hanging on for too long. It's hard to cut it off sometimes, I understand. Cut off the switch. But, yeah, I don't want to go over this. So here's my top five, and this might change as we move along. But one I want to first bring up is Uriah Faber just fought. California kid, followed him for 10 years, WEC champion. Good-looking dude, got the butt chin. I think he's 36. Good-looking short dude, ripped up. But, man, lost the last 3 out of 4, took a bad loss from Jimmy Rivera recently by decision. Previously got beat by Dominic Cruz. That's the third time they fought. But anyway, he's lost 3 out of 4. And I believe he's 0-4 in title matches in the UFC. So that was the one thing that he never could get as a UFC title fight. So great guy. He's got it. He's got his great alpha male gym going. So I think, man, just go back. And he's got all these businesses. He's written a book. So just maybe it's time to hang it up, man. Like,
what's just next on that list?
Yeah. That's another guy.
Okay, we're recording.
All right, and we're back. All right, so talk about Faber. My other guy is Travis Brown. He's won 2 out of his last 6, so lost 4. I don't know about necessarily just washed up, but, man, just hadn't looked the same. I know you're training in, I think it's California with Ronda Rousey. You probably got your girlfriend there. You know, she's accessible. But I think you need to go back to Greg Jackson's, man. You just really hadn't looked well. I mean, Verdun beat you for the second time. Cain Vasquez ran through you, murked you in that UFC 200. I mean, that spin kick in the first round was crazy. And I just think you need to go back, maybe Greg Jackson's, need to go back to Albuquerque. I know there's nothing to do there, but you got to get that hunger again, maybe get away from Rousey for a training camp. But if you want to do this again, you got to change training camps. And plus all that stuff with your trainer, I think he's just like a lot of negativity. So Travis Brown needs to change training camps or hang it up. I don't know what else you do, buddy. Go live off your girl, Ronda Rousey. You know, make some babies or something. Number 3, you probably heard of this one, Rashad Sugar Evans. He has lost 2 of his last 6. He's 36. His next fight is rumored to be, I don't think it's signed yet, at middleweight. Ex-UFC champion, great, beat Forrest Griffin back 2008, 2009. Great rivalry with Rampage Jackson. That was a great series. But, man, recently just being kind of beat up recently, went through a knee injury. I know it's tough. Hey, great on the mic. He's with Fox Sports 1, does a lot of the UFC commentary. So you could also train. You could be a trainer. You could be a UFC commentator. So if this maybe next fight at middleweight doesn't work, might be time to hang it up. I can see why you're hanging on. I think you're just recently going through a divorce. One of the worst fights of your life as a fighter that hangs on a lot, the ex-wife.
Wow.
What do you think about that, dog? Take it to the cleaners, man. Getting everything half. And you got some kids, man. child support, that's a whole other issue. I can see why you're hanging on. So number three, Rashad Evans. Number four, I think you should be one and done. CM Punk. Just talked about 38, got murked, got worked. I give it for you if you're getting in there, but did not deserve to be in there. So I give CM Punk number four. Don't need to do any more. I know you got that $10 million. You sued the WWE contract you got, so, man, you're living off that. I don't know what you can do. You got a comic book series. I learned all this by watching that reality show. So you're not hurting on money, but not sure if you want to do this anymore. Number five, you probably heard of this, BJ the Prodigy Penn. BJ back in the day, licking the gloves with the blood. At the time, late 2000s, 2008 or 9, best lightweight champ at the time, just running through people. Crazy knees, great jiu-jitsu on the ground. Just recently just been dominated. Actually hasn't had a win since 2010. And you got in trouble recently with tainted drugs with the IV or something, so there was a ban. I think you're out 6 months. Fighting Ricardo Lamas, coming off tough kid at 145. So, man, if you don't win this, I think you're like 16-10. Just need to hang it up. I mean, you haven't won one in 6 years. I just don't want you to taint your legacy. You don't need the money. I mean, you're from a wealthy family in Hawaii. You're well off. So I don't really know why you're doing this anymore. So if you lose this, you need to hang it up. So that's Trey's top five washed up list. We might add later down the line another list. We're going to call it maybe Vitamin S or the no gas list. That's basically five of the UFC fighters that are probably on steroids that have never been popped. And that's a whole other issue. And you can do this by the eye test. A lot of these dudes gassed out of their mind. Vitor Belfort back into there, as they like to call him, TRT Vitor, was running through kids. Just spin kicking guys, killing them. And then recently when he got off the TRT, got the dad bod going on and just been getting beat up. So we'll go over that. Also, Brock Lesnar, if you had any kind of half sense, you knew he was gassing. I mean, just monster. What do you think about Brock Lesnar back in the day, Nate Dogg? Monster, look at him. 265.
I feel that guy, like, pushed the limits of his athleticism. He tried to do UFC. He tried to be he did WWE for a while. He was a national champion wrestler in college. He even tried to play, like, I think, try to be a defensive lineman on the Minnesota Vikings. That didn't work out. So, yeah. One thing I want to ask, though.
Yeah, go ahead.
How long would you say is the lifespan of a UFC fighter?
Great question. Let's say it's evolved so much. Like, if you're looking at it, young sport, been around since 93. But, you know, some of these guys start at 20, 23, 24. And if I had to experimentally grow out of a microwave, a beast with the great tools, I would get one of these All-American Olympic wrestlers. Like this kid, Snyder, that just won gold at the Olympics, 170. Is the pedigree to be a great UFC fighter. I know a little bit by watching it, and I take Muay Thai. Is the wrestling pedigree, first off, great endurance, great cardio. They have a great will. They can do the weight cut because they do that for all their whole collegiate career and Olympics. Is putting one of these AKA, American Kickboxing Association, ATT camps, for striking for a year, just straight striking, and then every now and then work on that, throw some jiu-jitsu in there. So back to your question, I think a good 8-10 years without, you know, I think I've seen when you get 30-plus, kind of like a running back in the NFL, getting in those twilight years. So I'm thinking, like, and this is a young man's game, we've seen it is, just the more endurance, they're stronger, they're bigger, they're not punch drunk, as they say, because Chuck Liddell back in the day, you probably remember him, the Iceman, was rolling there, son, and then got four or five straight knockouts, glass jaws, just like, man, he's sticking that jaw there, people would hit it. So after you get those first couple of all the wars and everything that goes on the body, and then you're just your chin takes a beating, I'd say, you know, early 30s, you're getting trying to twilight your career.
So that seemed like guys. 6-8 years. Yeah. I've seen like guys like, even the first name on the list you mentioned, like you lose three fights, you're done. You're done in that level.
Yeah, you are, unless you won a title. But if you were brand new in the UFC and you dropped two or three, probably cutting you.
Yeah.
It's so competitive.
And, like, there's a long hill to get back up there again.
Yeah, there's other promotions. You got Bellator. It's probably the second one. They get a lot of the UFC rejects. I mean, they've got Benson Henderson. He used to be a champ over there. He came over, got Rampage Jackson. You got World Series of Fighting is another. So there's other options over there. You can ever even go for, is it 1F? 1F. No, one fight? One championship now? It's over in the Asian market. They get paid really well over there, but you got to travel to, Philippines. But there are other options. But, yeah, I mean, the grand mecca, the major leagues, the NFL is UFC.
UFC, and Bellator is just like a shabby knockoff.
It is kind of like TNA and wrestling, WWE. We can talk about wrestling, too. That's all another thing. Terrible product these days. I mean, you got Rock, Stone Cold coming in for WrestleMania trying to get him out. I love Rock, though. Hey, speaking of that, we can talk about that a little bit. WWE, best guy ever on the mic. Nate Dogg probably followed it. He's being from North Carolina back in the day.
Best guy ever on the mic.
Best guy on the mic. Gimmick, talk, maybe not worker in the ring. I know they've got podcasts each week. Jim Cornette, Jim Ross breaking down wrestling, old dudes coming in and talking to him. I know a little bit about WWE. But anyway, get Nate Dogg in here talking. Best guy on the mic you've seen, you just would watch. Maybe Monday Night Nitro or Raw back in the day. He was great. You're like, man, that guy's awesome.
Ooh, good question.
Or who's one of your favorite wrestlers growing up? I mean, I think everybody in their life, they won't admit it, followed wrestling for sure.
Oh, no. Like, when I was in high school, I was hardcore. Like, in.
Do you watch Raw or do you watch Nitro?
The funny thing is, in the living room, we had two TVs. For some weird reason, we had two TVs in the living room side by side.
Nice.
So, like, I had a splitter. I bought a splitter, I split the cable wire, one TV be Raw, one TV be Nitro.
Right.
And I did that for like several years. Because when I was a little kid, I liked it, and I was kind of in a lull period, and then I got really back into it again. So the first go around, I'll probably say my favorite was Sting.
Yes, had Sting poster in my room, bleached blonde hair.
And then the second go around when I went in high school, I was caught up in the Goldberg phase.
Oh, had Goldberg t-shirt too. I did. Go ahead.
Goldberg.
Hey, Goldberg, University of Georgia, lineman, defensive lineman, throw that in there. Also played a little bit for the Falcons.
Yeah, first ever cut up the Panthers.
He's good.
I was big on the Goldberg phase. I really did like the NWO.
Oh, yeah, they were awesome. For life.
Hollywood Hogan, Scott Hall.
Probably one of the best babyface turn heel, to get some wrestling terminology, is best heel takeover ever, Hollywood Hulk Hogan. Man, all the vitamins in the prayers, the red and the yellow, cried that day. It came out on WWE. Great, though. Great gimmick. Great gimmick and storyline. So that was awesome, him going over. I'd say for me recently, watch. All right, so what I've been doing, this is really weird. So Saturday mornings, I'll wake up 10 or 11, sleep in, probably from out drinking the night before, trying to get some bootay. I'll watch old Rock, Stone Cold, or random on my phone, laying in the bed, watch YouTube videos for some strange reason. It's like my Saturday thing of old wrestling. And to me, the best guys on the mic at prime were Stone Cold and, of course, Rock. Epic, like 15, 10 minute, just, going off. Rants, works, as they call them. I mean, the one where they sing to each other, stealing the mic, is awesome if you look that on YouTube. But, everybody started Stone Cold, the whole thing, what, drinking beer, selling out arenas. Check out his podcast, too. Stone Cold Unleashed is really good. Stone Cold Steve Austin show is really good. Rock's great, just great on the mic. He was great earlier in his career. Later in his career, he got a little mic too corporate. And then some of his most recent WrestleManias, you're like, Rock, man, love you, but get off the mic. You just prolong it 10, 15 minutes just babbling. So if you just went in there and said your taglines and get out. But anyway, that's a whole other thing. Rock doing great things. And
I was about to say something about you lying in your bed watching old Rock and Stone Cold going at it. But then I remember I still watched the Ric Flair, old Ric Flair, like,
woo, the Nature Boy.
Great on the mic, riding. Too. Jet flying, son of a gun.
Kissing Bob, yeah. He's great. Yeah, Ric Flair, great, man. I know financial problems, been in the media, but hey, Charlatanian, man. Charlotte all the way.
I spent even more money on spilt liquor.
Hey, and these shoes, then you got paid all year. Look at these shoes. Yeah, Ric Flair, great on the mic. Yeah, man. If you ever watched The Wrestler, the movie, Mickey Rourke, great wrestler movie. They showed like what happens after they kind of get washed up and they're over it. So anyway, that's the WWE. I didn't know we were going to talk about that, but good stuff.
Yeah.
We're going to now transition probably a little into the show. Maybe talk a little, we're both single, dating life.
Oh, boy.
And I can go on this forever. First off, I just want to say social media to me has ruined dating.
Okay, why do you say that? Why do you say social media has ruined dating?
All right, I'll admit, first off, it is accessible. It gives you more options. But it has made today's times, this generation, non-committal. And then the whole thing is, I even use it now just because it's in your DM. And that, hey, another thing, I'll get off on this. I probably go on this the whole podcast. But anyway, we'll make a thing. Is it non-committal, and I even do it, is the first term is you text a girl, you talk to them, hey, let's hang out. Hang out. But if you dare said the word date, there's like all these questions that go about, whoa, you said date. It's a lot of pressure. So you got your Bumbles, your Tinders, OkCupid, you know, Match.com, I'm sure you saw all these. I'm personally on Bumble. I say that right now. I think we are. What I like about Bumble, talking about that, all right, Tinder was like great for a while, but I started running into these sex bots a lot. And you get a cute girl, not a lot of, I mean, they wouldn't show a lot of like slutty clothing. You're like, all right. And then you'd like, hey, come look at my camera, or here's my number and come see me, or she'd say something really sexual. And I just like, after that, you get like a couple of those. I mean, like, come on, man. This is just like I'm connected with sex bots. So Tinder to me, over it. I did go through a little phase. I think I met one girl out there, and of course, I won't say her name, but about 3 months, not bad on Tinder. But Bumble, what I liked about it, and you know, I'm wanting to know, is the fact is, I think Tinder scared off a lot of people, as you get a lot of like creepers, as they would say, out there, saying a lot of random stuff. So Bumble, what I like about it is the girl has to reach out first. But it can also say it kind of handcuffs you as a guy, because you're like, hey, I got a connection, this girl's cute, can't do anything, you can do the extended. And then after that, it just slowly disappears, and it goes back into, you know,
the cyberverse.
Cyberface. So, but anyway, what's your thoughts on that, the whole dating? I just think it's messed up, not non-committal, and just makes it really, really tough. But there are options out there. And then in Charlotte, as we know, you go through the same circle of people. You go out and you see the same circle of people. The candy bars, Bubble, you know, Bubble's
old. Yeah.
Music Factory. Wait,
I don't know how many times I've gone out, like, just the same typical young professional, whatever, spots. And I've seen some girl that you probably linked up with before. And it's getting kind of annoying, Trey.
Damn.
They don't know me, but I remember them from, like, you going on a date with them or just somewhere, just bumping into them. I don't know, like, I could go on about this whole dating thing. I'll just start off with this. First off, I'm socially awkward. So, I don't really like the approach because, or even if someone even came up and approached me, because it's kind of like, all right, what do you want? What's your angle here?
Got your guard up.
Yeah, I've always had my guard up, and I don't really let people in easily. So that's just a personal thing there. I'll say over years I've had my chances, but always find a way to sabotage them. Because sometimes it's kind of like you're just afraid it might work. So you know, it's kind of like this fear of success.
Yeah.
Because then it's just like, all right, so you got it right once, so you're going to keep trying to recreate the formula of trying to do it again.
Yeah.
And it gets tiring. Dating around here, this is pretty much been non-existent. And in the times I did have dates, like, I've just done something to, like, screw it up. So, it kind of sucks, too, because, like, I'll be, like, 33 next week and giving away my age.
Damn.
It sucks. But it's just like, all right, it's, like, to the point now where I just look at somebody and then she may be attractive, and then it's kind of just like, ah, what's the point? Yeah. What's the point? Why like go through all this energy trying to impress this woman, and if at the end of the day, there's a great percentage of chance it's not going to work out?
Yeah.
So that's just a little bit of how I feel about that. Dating websites, those don't work for me. Those don't work for me. And it is true. Like, around here, you just see the same folks.
Yeah.
Same kind of old.
And they keep saying, you know, Charlotte, million plus, you know, fast growing. I'm like, man, where's all the new recruits at? You know, where's all these people at? Got all these, like, apartments throwing up everyone in Uptown. Like, where are they at? See the same people, like I said. So I'm waiting for that five-star recruit to come out. You know?
Maybe that's the problem.
And I will say I've gotten pickier because usually doing pretty good with the ladies. Met a lot of girls in my life, but I guess to the point I hadn't felt the right one, but I think it's made me a little spoiled because I'm like, yeah, that one's okay. There's probably a better one out there.
So do you have a fear of commitment?
Yeah, I do have commitment issues. We can go into that. It could be I don't have mommy issues. Great relationship with my mom, parents. Great upbringing in a little small town in Georgia. That's where I'm from. But yeah, just recently, like, and another thing I always tell people is, another funny thing is, there's probably been 10 or 12 girls right after me that got married.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you ever watch the movie Good Luck Chuck, I'm Good Luck Trey. I tell the girl, hey, I'll get you married, just not to me. So,
So what do you feel you need to do? Do you need to open up more? Do you just need to relax?
Yeah, first off, I guess to be brutally honest, like I know we were talking about we are the unemployable. The whole like getting a consistent job, because my theory on this, man, I'm getting deep here on the first podcaster, is my theory is I'll bounce around on jobs that if you ever notice anybody, it could be wrong, that if a person has been steady or been committed to a job, you know, 5-10 years or whatever it is, probably going to be committed in their relationship. So I've bounced around, and I've bounced around women. So I'm thinking, like, maybe I've never been comfortable in my skin professionally first to be ready for a committed relationship. But, and there's been some I've been, like, really head over heels over, really, really cared about them, that they just weren't really into me. So I think that maybe being scared to get really close or getting hurt, because I've been hurt in the past, and I've hurt women, you know? So I don't really know. I'm still waiting. But I don't want to feel that pressure. Everybody's getting married. Nate Dahl's probably been to it recently. You go to these weddings, and I'm glad I'm not and on the other hand, I'm not glad I'm not in a miserable marriage. And you meet guys, and you're like, hey, man, what'd you do this weekend? I want to live vicariously through you. Or I got the kids this weekend. You're doing this. Like, you can kind of tell they're yearning to be where I am at. So I'm glad I'm not there that way. But, you know, sometimes at the end of the night when you go to bed, you're like, put your head on the pillow. You're like, it can be cool to have somebody. But
I wholeheartedly agree with you on the whole career thing.
Yeah.
Like, if you're not comfortable with yourself professionally, because, like, it's the same problem, too. Like, I'm not where exactly I want to be in, because maybe in my body language, it shows that.
Right.
And it just kind of gives that out. So I'm not happy where I'm at.
Love confidence.
Yeah.
It's proven.
So it's confidence is obviously not exuding there. Also, yeah, just you also shouldn't have to do something where you feel like you're forced into it.
Exactly.
You know, like, if you just, you shouldn't just like, oh, well, like, settle. Yeah, settle. You shouldn't settle. Like, somebody just feel decent. All right, let's just go. Because eventually there's going to be problems down the line, and you might end up regretting it. It may be just be better off just being alone.
Yeah.
That way, you don't have to bring someone else into the issues that you're not comfortable with right now. You're not ready to deal with. I wholeheartedly agree with you on that point. But.
Yeah, we'll maybe bring this up at, you know, later time. We can tackle more of the dating. We just wanted to kind of dab into that, stick a little toe in there. The way I like to tell one of our good friends we know is, my dating thing is, you're in a pool. You like to kind of maybe stick a toe in there. I'm sitting down there on the shallow end. And as our buddy, you know who I'm talking about, who just recently got married, he just went kaboosh in the deep end with a cannonball. Waving at me, and I'm like, hey, man, I'm down here, my swimmy's on, about to kind of step in the dating pool here. But
And I got my swim shorts on, but I'm, like, outside the clubhouse deciding if I want to go in or not.
Yeah, I'm like, hey, Nate Dogg, we're in here.
Hey, the water's fine. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
I'm still thinking about if I want to come in or not. Let me go take this call.
There you go. Nice. But yeah, we'll probably talk. We'll probably there's a lot of course dating issue out there. But anyway, thought great opening podcast today. You know, talk a little college football.
Yeah, we went a little long.
Talk a little NFL. Yeah, we'll kind of, hey, like I said, hey, opening pilot episode. We just wanted to get our feet wet, try this. We're
clearly winging this right now.
Exactly. And we wanted, we'll probably have to see how the audio sounds here, how the mics were.
Right.
But thought it was a great podcast. Talk a little pro football, UFC, talk a little college football, Bulldogs, and also a little dating. So we're signing off here. Trey and Nate Dogg, Unemployable from beautiful uptown Charlotte. And go Dogs and go Panthers.